Can I welcome everyone to the 20th meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from James Donlan. Agenda item 1 is a decision on taking business in private. The committee will decide whether to take agenda items 3 and 4, consideration of the committee's approach to the proposed private tenancies bill and its draft budget scrutiny 2016-17 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. We now move to agenda item 2, where the committee will receive an update from the Minister for Transport and Islands, Derek Mackay, on current transport projects and policy issues. Can I welcome the Minister and Aidan Grisewood, Director of Rail, and Michelle Rennie, Director of Major Transport Infrastructure Projects at the Scottish Government. And can I invite the Minister to make an opening statement?
Okay, thank you, Convener. And I've got a comprehensive opening statement, which I'm sure will
be fine.
Lead to questions. Can I share the progress on transport and our contribution to the government's objective of sustainable economic growth? First of all, I'm sure that we're all delighted to see the opening of the Borders Railway, the longest domestic railway to be constructed for over 100 years since opening. Thousands of passengers have travelled on the new Borders Railway line to the extent that ScotRail are adding extra carriages to some of their trains. The Winchborough Tunnel reopened after a six-week closure of the line to passenger services on Monday the 27th of July, as planned by the Egypt team. This was the most significant piece of engineering work on the Edinburgh to Glasgow rail line since the Victorian era. And this is happening against the backdrop of the largest investment in the road programme that Scotland has ever seen. On the AWPR, the main construction works officially got underway in February of this year, after the First Minister took part in the groundbreaking ceremony. The next phase of works on the A93 are expected to be completed by November and involve utility companies diverting their services, clearing the way for the main AWPR works. This summer, a major milestone was reached by the £500 million M8, M73, M74 motorway improvement project, when the new rail bridge, weighing in excess of 2,000 tonnes, slid into its final position over what will become the new M8 motorway to join the existing Cuttysark rail bridge at Burgeddy in Glasgow. The fourth replacement crossing is being built on time and under budget. The deck lifting has now started. And back in May, the traffic lights at Pulpit Rock were finally removed for the first time in over 30 years. And the viaduct, which now carries traffic over the shores of Loch Lomond, is a remarkable engineering achievement. The First Minister recently launched Scotland's Economic Strategy. This is the overarching framework for a Scotland based on prosperity, fairness and participation, and transport, of course, plays its part in all four priorities. Around innovation, we've been making progress in technology such as hydrogen and fuel cell sector, a key funder of the Aberdeen Hydrogen Bus project, which has seen the establishment of Europe's largest fleet of hydrogen-fueled buses, supported by the state-of-the-art green hydrogen production and refuelling facility. We're also working with a range of transport partners on integrated transport and smart ticketing. Also, we'll have further opportunities with procurement and franchise arrangements going forward. On internationalisation, we're working with our airports and our airline sector to improve Scotland's aviation connectivity. And we have a Team Scotland approach here, which has achieved some remarkable success. On inclusive growth, we spend over £1 billion on public transport and other sustainable transport options, which is about providing people with access to the transport system. The new ScotRail passenger rail franchise operates over 2,270 trains each day, delivering 93 million passenger journeys per year, and is the single biggest contract led by Scottish ministers, worth a total value of over £7 billion over the 10-year period. And members are well aware of the commitments around significant improvements in innovation as part of the rail franchise around improved services, trains and facilities, and it will also be a lever into improved smart technology as well. Since 2007, we've invested over £15 billion in transport, including roads and railways, and the ferry network, six new ferries, have been introduced to the CalMAC services. That's an investment of over £100 million. A third hybrid is currently under construction in the Clyde, and two large ferries are currently out to tender for delivery in 2017-2018. And members will be very mindful of the debate in the Chamber yesterday around island communities on timetables, the rollout of RET, the extension of their discount scheme, and progress in aviation also. We're steadily increasing investment in low-carbon, sustainable and active travel, delivering on our manifesto commitment. And as I wrote to you, the National Transport Strategy of 2006 set a framework for transport in Scotland up to the period 2026. It's setting out a transport vision, high-level objectives and key strategic outcomes, and this document is being refreshed in partnership with COSLA to be complete by Christmas. A range of other works I'm happy to go into questions on in terms of infrastructure projects, but I would finally want to, of course, celebrate, as we all would, the fact that the Forth Bridge was officially recognised by UNESCO at the World Heritage Site this summer, and that has been supported by Transport Scotland as well. Convener, I could have gone on longer, but I see I'm testing your patience, so I'll draw my remarks to close and open up to questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mackay. Perhaps I could kick off with some questions on high-speed rail. The Scottish Government is engaging with the High Speed 2 company and officials at the UK Department of Transport for Transport on the development of a UK high-speed rail network. Transport Scotland announced in early September that a report jointly commissioned by the UK and Scottish Governments on high-speed rail route options to Scotland will be completed by the end of the year. Are you still on track, if you pardon the pun, to meet that publication deadline? And can you give us any flavour of the, without obviously breaching the embargo, of any of the themes that are emerging from that piece of work?
Well, I can answer the question by saying no, I can't give you a flavour because it is exactly as you describe an emerging piece of work, so it would be inappropriate and premature to do that. But yes, we are on track to have that piece of work complete by that timescale, and it should put the Cabinet Secretary in a position to say more next year. And once we have issues information around the high-level costings, route options and other detail, then I'm sure we'll be happy to share that more widely. But yes, that piece of work is on track between the Department for Transport and Transport Scotland.
If you're not able or willing to share with us, I accept it's probably more likely to be the former rather than the latter, the content of that piece of work, can you give us a little bit more on the process that the government will be engaging in as these plans are developed for an Anglo-Scottish high-speed rail?
So a lot of the decisions and work that will come from the joint study will need to be considered. So that would be future issues that we would need to look at, such as route options, costing, and everything else that lies behind that, such as how it's paid for and how it could progress. So all of that will emerge from the joint study. And it is really important on this issue to work in partnership with the UK government, Department for Transport, the experts that they have with Transport Scotland and Scottish Government, because we don't accept that it would be good enough for high-speed rail to physically go to the north of England and not physically come to Scotland. And that's the high-level principle, that we want it to physically extend to Scotland, because you could go on and ask about the Edinburgh to Glasgow connection as well. And we said, again, as principle, we would want both cities to be connected. Again, that's a high-level principle that we would want to achieve. How you achieve that can only be determined once we've got the joint study, because, as I say, again, that will set out the options, the high-level costs, and then serious negotiations follow from that. How is it structured? How is it delivered? How is it paid for? And what would that look like? Because this, of course, would be a hugely expensive yet worthwhile infrastructure investment that will reduce journey times to London in a way that makes it more competitive and useful to use rail travel to get to London than, for example, air travel. So there's a lot in this, big investment, a lot of work to be done, and I'm not being obtuse about sharing information from an emerging study, but it really is a case of we have to get the space for that report to conclude and keep partnership working with the UK government in the spirit that we have done to try and take it forward in a constructive manner. So I'm not withholding anything from committee, it's just that it genuinely is an ongoing piece of work.
Presumably, officials at the Scottish Government have done some indicative work on what the level of investment required would be for in order to extend high-speed rail to Scotland?
Any sort of detail or figures would be premature, because it is this current piece of work that will inform that will give high-level figures and options in terms of route as well, that then leads to those further discussions. Anything else is a rough estimate and guesstimate. We know that it's feasible to have high-speed rail come to Scotland, but the more technical and detailed issues is now what's under investigation and appraisal.
That's fine, but my question was, you might not be in a position to share that work with us today, and I accept this discrete piece of work is ongoing, but my question was, has the Scottish Government done any early preparatory work on what the cost involved would be, even if you're not able to share that? Has that work been done?
Well, Michelle might want to say a bit, or Aidan, in fact, since it's railways, major projects, but railways, I'll let Aidan cover that.
Well, this is work that's been taken forward by HS2, so the commission is from DfT and Transport Scotland, and that's been taken forward by HS2, but as the Minister said, there isn't a definitive point where, you know, and that's the whole point of the ongoing work, is the emerging work, and as we get towards the end of the year, then that's where we get to a point where we can crystallise upon a number, and even that number, given the nature of and the long timescales around something as big as high speed, would inevitably be indicative in itself. You know, so it would be at a point of maturity associated with the level of detail that the business case had got to at that point. But yeah, we can't share anything at this point. There hasn't been any definitive indicative number that we could use at this point.
Right, OK. I'm not sure if that's a yes or a no in terms of whether the work's been done or not. But
I'll give you a... No, we don't have an indicative figure then, as in terms of Scottish Government.
Right, OK. Also assume then that you're not in a position yet to tell us whether the financing route would be the traditional capital expenditure route or the non-profit distribution model? That will be determined at a later stage, is that correct?
That's correct.
Right, OK. In terms of Edinburgh-Glasgow high-speed railway, which you mentioned, is there anything that you want to put on the record at this stage?
Again, it's the aspiration that we want both cities to enjoy the physical benefits of high-speed rail should it come to Scotland, and therefore we were looking at the connections either between the cities or how the high-speed rail potentially could connect to both. But clearly there would be no sense in progressing with that until we have a decision on the wider high-speed rail issue. So no, I can't report anything further on that, because everything will be informed by the current joint study.
Right, and so we can expect further details on that proposed scheme at the same time as the study is published or at a later stage?
Well, yes, decisions about the Edinburgh to Glasgow connection would flow from the decisions, yes, of the joint study and any discussions we'd have with UK Government.
OK. I'll pass to my colleague Adam, who has some questions.
Thanks, Convener. Morning, Minister. I'd like to focus on Network Rail. The Office of Rail and Roads has raised concerns about Network Rail's performance in Scotland and its impact on passenger services. How is Transport Scotland working with Network Rail and Abellio to improve that performance?
Well, we have regular meetings with Network Rail and Abellio ScotRail. One of the innovations we have in Scottish Rail at the moment is the connection, the new deep alliance that brings Network Rail and ScotRail together, and I think that's good for accountability and the ability to make decisions and investments as well. So hopefully that will pay dividends in the months and years to come. But in terms of the ORR's criticism of Network Rail, I think it's valid. Network Rail has been in some difficulty across the UK in terms of some of the projects that it has been delivering. In terms of Scotland, we would want even greater accountability, transparency, indeed devolution of Network Rail to Scotland to get on and make some of the decisions that we would like to see taken closer to home. But if there is any breach or a departure from what we would expect as a government, there are regulatory matters and franchise agreements when it comes to Abellio ScotRail. But in terms of Network Rail, we do hold them to account for any discrepancy or impact on service. We have had, despite the criticism progress, of course, on the Winchborough Tunnel, which was a major piece of engineering work which will make a difference to the Edinburgh-Glasgow Improvement Programme, is absolutely vital. So there are success stories, but yes, there have been concerns about Network Rail's wider performance and ongoing costs of some of their projects. So we monitor it very closely. And I should say that in terms of what's happening south of the border, there are a number of reviews of the rail sector and Network Rail by UK government, and we'll obviously monitor that very closely. But within Scotland, all our rail commitments will be kept. There'll be no impact on our current programme, but that said, we're watching performance very closely and are very mindful of the experience south of the border, where they're having to go back to basics, to use that term, on their investment programme because of some of the disruptive issues there. That's not the case in Scotland.
Okay. Monitoring by Transport Scotland is one thing. Engagement by Transport Scotland is another. And I understand the UK government has asked Nicola Shaw, Chief Executive of High Speed 1, to review the operation of Network Rail UK-wide. So what involvement has Transport Scotland had in this review, and what, and flowing from that, what impact might any changes to Network Rail's structure or ownership have on Scotland?
Well, ministers, not just officials, will have both engagement and involvement this week when myself and the Cabinet Secretary meet Nicola Shaw. So I think that will be helpful. And of course, officials engage with the Department for Transport and any wider review, sharing our expertise, our experience, and the issues that we see as pertinent to Scotland. But I say again, of interest to the committee, we don't think on this occasion that it's good enough just to have London-based reviews and London-based and Westminster-based control. We see real merit in further devolution of Network Rail coming to Scotland, indeed this government and this parliament, so we can make decisions for ourselves around how Network Rail does its business. For example, the current review is looking at the issue of potential privatisation of Network Rail. That is not something that the Scottish Government would support, and therefore it's a good example of how we might like to do things differently with Network Rail within a Scottish context. So there's regular engagement, regular involvement, regular participation with Network Rail, but the more accountability we have, the better. And that's why I say again that the new alliance that we have has empowered Scotland more in terms of the rail sector to get on with investment and operational decisions. And of course, we'll participate in any review and watch very closely the outcome of those reviews through the Department of Transport as they relay it to Transport Scotland. And ministers regularly make contact with UK ministers on all transport matters. Hopefully that answers Mr. Ingram's questions.
Yeah, I'm pleased to hear that, and perhaps we might get some feedback from your meeting in due course. Network Rail is currently reviewing its Control Period 4 capital investment programme. Does this have any implications for the development of the rail network in Scotland?
I think in terms of the current control period, to be clear, there is no impact. The commitments, the enhancements that we've programmed for are not impacted by the decisions south of the border. But of course, there are wider financial issues, spending review and financial pressures that all government departments would be under at the moment. But no, in essence, we are carrying on with our real commitments as described for the current control period. And as I say, we'll participate in any ongoing review coming from Network Rail.
Okay, thank you.
Siobhan.
Convener. Minister, you mentioned in the opening statement about the National Transport Strategy, the refresh of it, and you wrote to the convener last month to let the committee know of the plans. From that, we understand that review will be carried out in conjunction with COSLA, as you said, but will be limited in scope, only considering two aspects. Why have you decided to limit the scope in such a way, given that the publication hasn't been updated in 9 years?
I think that's a very good question, a very good point. There was no plan for a refresh or a review at all, as it happens, and I thought as Minister it was good time to have, not just because I was a relatively new Minister, but I felt that you're right, it required a refresh. But the reason the scope is limited, it's really by necessity. It's not just the time constraints. A new Parliament may wish to reconsider a more in-depth review of the National Transport Strategy, and then that would be the next Parliament's right, and the next Minister, whoever that may be, their right as well. The high level, in terms of Scottish Government, though, the high level objectives haven't changed. The transport strategy as a whole hasn't changed. The infrastructure investment plan isn't proposed to change. And with all that in mind, what I wanted to focus on is, although the world has moved on over the period since the last publication, I felt there was an opportunity to update it. So we're not revisiting the fundamentals or the major investment plans. That work has been done. It's about ensuring it's up to date and has clarity around responsibility, and it reflects today's society and today's transport issues. And that's why I felt that a refresh was more appropriate to a comprehensive review. And I'm doing that in partnership with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities. So it is an ambitious timescale. That's civil service code for that's really difficult. The instruction I've given is I want it complete for Christmas so that it's up to date. It is refreshed. It makes it clear about transport responsibilities. It captures current progress. And absolutely, you're right, there's an opportunity to revisit it more comprehensively in the future if any government or parliament wishes to do so. And then that would unlock all the other consultative mechanisms that you would probably want to deploy for a wholesale review. This is not a wholesale review, and I've been clear about that. It's purely a refresh, but a much-needed refresh, I would argue.
I presume that's the reason then it's not going out to consultation, the time limits, and given that it's not touching on anything fundamental, those will remain the same, so that's the reason a consultation's not taking place.
Exactly, because if I embarked on a wholesale consultation, for example, the kind of consultation that the National Planning Framework, when I was Planning Minister, I had the pleasure and joy of undertaking, went through parliamentary scrutiny, public scrutiny, full comprehensive consultation. I think it would have raised expectations if it went through the same process. But the beauty of this is that if a comprehensive review is conducted in the next Parliament, it could, for example, be done in tandem with the National Planning Framework for, you know, the next National Planning Framework. So I think there's synergies that can come from doing it in the next Parliament. And for the current exercise, I wouldn't want you to think there's no consultation, because there is. There's the involvement with our democratically elected councils through COSLA. There's engagement through the stakeholder group as well for the National Transport Strategy. And there'll be other sectoral opportunities as well. For example, when I have the Active Travel Summit imminently, I'll raise the National Transport Strategy there as well. So there is an opportunity to engage, but for the purposes of the refresh, it is more of an update than a revisiting of the fundamental issues.
You mentioned the stakeholder group, so what role will they play in the process, and who will make up that group?
I'm happy to share the composition of the stakeholder group and its remit, if that's of assistance to the committee. Its role is to advise and support and in a sense challenge what we propose through the National Transport Strategy as well. And it's wide-ranging from across the transport community. It'll engage, but it's very much sectors. It will engage with the strategy, and I propose that COSLA also engage as well. One of the biggest issues for me, so if we outline what we're doing as a government through the Infrastructure Investment Plan, so I think it's clear what our transport investment plans are and our general strategy is. It's been communicated through the government's economic strategy as well. But one area of weakness I do think that has existed hitherto is around, say, clarity of local transport responsibility. So if you take, say, bus provision or where there's gaps in service, I want people to be clear how that can be resolved. And I think the National Transport Strategy can do that. And I won't be changing the law necessarily or changing government priorities, but making it clear where responsibility rests. And that's why it doesn't need more consultation, but it certainly needs more clarity. And I hopefully that explains more of that that engagement. But there will be engagement through the stakeholder group, and I'll share the membership composition with the committee.
Thank you.
Alex.
very much, convener. Excuse me, Minister, if I jump around a bit, I've got a few subjects I need to cover. The first one is air passenger duty. The programme for government indicates that you're currently consulting with aviation stakeholders on how best to reduce air passenger duty should the relevant powers be transferred to the Scottish Parliament. Can you set out how any such reduction in air passenger duty might work and what the impact of that could be on Scottish tax receipts?
The commitment that we've made publicly is that we'd want to reduce the burden of APD in Scotland by 50% in the first instance, then abolish it as resources would allow. The exact mechanics of that, how you would do it, how you would implement the reduction will be a matter for government to consider, but through the new stakeholder group that we've established, and that brings together airlines, airports, other business interests, as well as environmental representatives as well, and we'll look at the structure of that reduction and come back with the administration. The implementation date is April 2018, which has been shared with the stakeholder group and other interested parties. So we'll move towards that infrastructure for that implementation date. High-level objectives, a reduction by 50% leading into total abolition as resources allow. Beyond that, I can't say any more because it's not been determined, and we'll do it with the engagement of the new stakeholder group.
But you are surely in a position to have an estimate of what the impact on tax receipts would be of a 50% or 100% reduction?
The earlier estimates came from the work done for Scotland's future, and I don't want to do it off the top of my head, but we did have a rough cost estimate around that. Now, if I said from memory, I think the total amount generated from APD was around £200 million, so a 50% reduction would suggest £100 million, but please allow me to check those facts and come back to committee.
And I'm sure also that since the work is a couple of years old now, it may actually have changed, so it would be useful to have an update on that.
Exactly.
The next subject I wanted to cover is the junction on the A90 at Lawrence Kirk. Now, myself and the local member Nigel Doan have been working for some time to push that on this committee's agenda and trying to push it up your agenda. And when it was last mentioned in Parliament during debate, you gave some encouragement on that area. So I wondered if you could provide a progress report on the development of a grade-separated junction at the A90, A937 at Lawrence Kirk, including how that might be funded and when you might expect this work to take place.
Mr. Johnson's absolutely right. Both he and other members have been pushing this issue towards me. I wish some extra resources were passed towards me from the UK government as well to match the aspirations of Conservative members. But you're right.
It's you'd come in, it's announced this week.
Yes, I believe it when I see it. And we'll see how that fits in with the overall spending exchange. I'm delighted to hear it, so I look forward to further resources to assist with our capital programme. I think it's a very serious issue and a very serious point. Lawrence Kirk Junction is absolutely on my radar as a priority piece of work that we would like to be able to undertake. The current position is I had a meeting with interested parties, that was the local authorities and the private sector as well, and we have made progress on the technical solutions. We can continue to move forward on that. In terms of funding, which is the critical question, I don't have an answer to that as yet, although I've established a coordination group to see how people can contribute towards that potential junction. That involves the local authorities, of course Transport Scotland, and potentially the private sector, because the junction there would also unlock economic opportunity and address development constraints as well. So it's not just as simple as saying to government, can we find the cash, although I wish we could do it as simply as that. But we're looking at trying to innovate and get contributions from other partners, such as the private sector and the local authorities. Now, that might be by the way of developer contributions, but I also don't want the funding package to be so complex that it can't reach completion or even beginning of construction. So I am continuing to work with this. I have established a stakeholder group and we'll look at the costings of it. Mr. Johnson's well aware of the substantial financial commitments we've made around the road network, for example, the A9, which is a substantial investment in the duelling thereof, as well as other commitments. But Lawrence Kirk, I say again, is a priority to looking at how we can progress with it, and the stakeholder group the coordination group, as I should say, will look at how it can be financed, and work is underway on that. But I can't give a timescale because it does all come from that financial commitment.
I welcome the fact that the Minister is probably the first Transport Minister in 10 years who has taken the matter as seriously as you do. But the danger is that that also raises expectations. And I think we have a work to do to ensure that these expectations are fulfilled. The next question I have is covers the subject you've just touched on a moment ago, and it was essentially to ask for an update on where we are with the M8 completion project, the A9 dualling, and the construction of the AWPR. And I think to some extent you've covered that, but is there anything further you wish to add?
Only that all of these projects are going well, and with all of them, when work appears on the ground, people see things happening and then believe that the work is underway. That's the good side of disruptive works happening. The downside, of course, that investment works, multi-billion pound investment in the road network from the Queensferry crossing, the A9 and the motorway bundle as described, will also cause some disruption. So I apologise for that disruption, but surely everyone can agree that the investment is worthwhile, and the long-term benefits of an improved infrastructure, improved journey times and reduced congestion is well worth it. All of these projects are going in a satisfactory manner in terms of their completion dates and the work underway, so I wouldn't want to add anything specific, but I'm happy to take any more questions.
Yeah. On the issue of the impact on the ground, I've already written to the Minister directly on a couple of cases that have been brought to my attention. Of course, the public relations work that was carried out in conjunction with the Fourth Bridge project is something of an exemplar of how that might best be achieved. Are you able to give me any further reassurances that that same standard will be achieved in relation to the construction work on the AWPR?
Yes, I am, and I'd expect the highest levels of engagement, community engagement, and showcasing through exhibits and consultation on the work that's been undertaken. Mr. Johnson's absolutely right. He challenged me on, was it the case that we were closing down communication and consultation on the roadworks on the A9, having done such a good job in other places? And I checked with officials, and it wasn't true at all, and I was happy to convey the message that we fully expect full consultation, engagement, showcasing and exhibitions from the previously successful Transport Scotland project. So full coordination of that continues, and if it's not being received at local communities, I'd want to know about it.
Again on the AWPR, but a slightly different issue. The project was recently reclassified by the Office of National Statistics as being under public sector control, and this has since been highlighted by Audit Scotland. The Scottish Government indicated in July that this would have no implications for the cost or project timetable, and that you would seek to have the project reclassified back to the private sector. Can you provide an update on progress to have the project reclassified as private, and are you confident that your project remains on time and on budget?
Yes. I'm totally confident that the project remains on time and on budget, and that will be the most important matter, I think, for residents and businesses in the area. So I can categorically say that. As to the wider matter of the accountancy exercise, that's something, of course, that the Finance Secretary continues to engage with, and I'm sure will report to Parliament any changes as a consequence of those discussions. But in terms of the current programme, yes, they will continue unaffected in terms of the work being delivered on budget and on time.
Thank you very much.
Siobhan, did you have a supplementary?
Yes, it was on the M8 completion project. You'll be aware that there's a lot of work going on at the Wraith interchange at present, and that there's average speed cameras of 50 miles per hour. I was just wondering if, not today, Minister, but if you have facts and figures about those who are observing that, or how many people have been fined for not observing the average speed, because there's a lot of people on the road working on that project at the minute, as obviously you'll be aware, and just for safety reasons, as a local member in that area, I would like to know if people are observing those signs.
I think that's a very fair point. So whilst we're all accepting and welcoming the investment and the works that will improve the capacity of the M8, M73, M74, all worthwhile projects, These, of course, are live roadworks, and as 100,000 vehicles pass through a live site, it of course is a concern for safety. So safety is never compromised, and the average speed cameras have been deployed successfully in other parts of the country to try and manage driver behaviour and keep the road safety risks to a minimum. So I'm happy to share, once I have some information on their deployment, that information with the committee. But the high level commitment around safety is continuing to be maintained, and I'm happy to at some point in the future give a fuller report on the progress of those works also.
Thank you. Can I ask you about active travel, an issue that you've taken close interest in since you became Transport Minister? And you mentioned the Active Travel Summit. It's now 5 years since the original version of the Cycling Action Plan for Scotland was published. Currently, 2.6% of journeys to work and 1.7% of journeys to school are made by bike. There are 5 years to go to meet the vision of 10% of everyday journeys by bike by 2020. Does that strike you as being, to use the civil service speak, an ambitious target, or one that you can achieve with appropriate commitment and investment?
I think, convener, it is particularly ambitious. It's not a target, it is a vision. You referenced the Cycling Action Plan. The next iteration of it will be published at the end of 2016. But as you have referred to, there's been a great deal of action around infrastructure spend and behaviour change programmes as well, such as those around community links, the cycling and walking paths, bikeability training within schools as well. And the financial commitments that I've made as Transport Minister as well. So we had record investment in the last financial year, and I've committed to within this financial year increasing on that record investment. And I know that that's been welcomed, but many within the active transport community will want us to do much more. So the Active Travel Summit will bring together local authority partners so I can impress upon them the priority that the government believes should be attached to active travel, as well as the other schemes that government is currently supporting. This week, I had the pleasure of opening the new Route 78 on the National Cycle Network, which goes through the Highlands and is a particularly beautiful route, which of course has part of the route separated. Beautiful going through the Great Glen, but part of the route separated as well. I know much of the walking and cycling community, particularly the cycling community, will want more separated routes. So even looking at road design, when we're designing new roads and infrastructure, we think about pedestrians and cyclists also. So it's not just the active travel budget that matters, but the cross-portfolio interventions that we can make. And I also had a meeting with other ministers on specifically active travel, such as health and sport, as well, to focus on what other government departments can do around the walking and cycling strategies also. So it's not just about money, but a range of interventions should allow us to achieve that vision. And there is evidence of culture change elsewhere in the world where there was quite a rapid uptake in active travel, and particularly cycling, when the right interventions were made. But in partnership with local authorities and other stakeholders, I know that there's much more work to be done, and I'll continue to attach a high priority to it as Transport Minister.
OK, thank you for that. Can you provide an update on the implementation of the National Walking Strategy?
Well, the Walking Delivery Forum will convene for the first time in November 2015, and officials will work closely with Pass for All to support the delivery of the strategy that's been outlined. And as I understand it, that will be chaired by the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport, because of their involvement in the National Physical Activity Implementation Plan.
The success of the strategy in terms of its implementation going to be monitored and reported on?
Well, I'd have to come back to you more of the detail on that. It's health colleagues that lead in this particular issue, but I'd imagine that there will be full monitoring of it, which can be reported back to the committee. But certainly in terms of the Cycling Action Plan and the and the support that Transport Scotland and my officials will engage with. We'll certainly play our strong part in that wider strategy.
Okay, thank you, Dave.
Minister, I just want to ask a few questions around the Borders Railway, and I echo your earlier comments. Certainly for my part, I welcome the opening of Borders Rail, and I was monitoring the media comments, which were very positive from the public, and it's been well used. Just before I focus on the specifics, effectively what you were doing there was, and there was cross-party support, as you recall, for this project, is winding back some of the beaching cuts, which across Scotland, you'll know that there is some rail lines which were there in beaching days and now are no longer used. Have you had a look at reopening other old rail lines in a longer project? And secondly, not just for passengers, I'm very keen in looking at freight-only lines. You'll know from our freight inquiry that we went to Rotterdam to look at the freight-only railway line that they developed from Rotterdam to Germany, which on memory was around €4 billion, which I'm not suggesting that you spend in the next few weeks, but certainly was a world-breaking project and received considerable European funding, which, as you know, I have a particular interest in. So before I touch on Borders, have you any plans to look at reopening old lines, particularly on the routes of the old beaching cuts?
Mr. Stewart, it probably would be as excited as I would be at the prospect of reopening lines that had been closed through that process. And Mr. Stewart might not know, but actually my hometown of Renfrew is the largest town in Scotland without a railway station, but it has a railway line. It used to have far more going to even Paisley as well as Glasgow. But it's just one example of many communities that I think could benefit from rail extension. Rail is a real success story in this country now, is it not, with increasing patronage, improving access and connectivity, and of course making a contribution to the environmental agenda as well and reducing emissions. So of course government would be keen to extend rail lines further, and Borders an example, of course, it could go further itself, but it really is now down to available resources. Something like rail services are 75% subsidised in terms of the overall package, the overall cost of rail. And the infrastructure costs, of course, are significant. So it really is down to financial availability. But if you take a project such as Borders, we're constantly asked, can it be extended further? So we'll check we'll keep an eye and monitor the feasibility, the current usage, and consider regularly a range of bids around enhancement of rail infrastructure. But the main issue around it is availability of resources. And this government has made substantial commitments around rail investment, some of which you know very well on the Highland Main Line and Aberdeen to Inverness commitments as well within current control periods. And we'll have further work to do on the electrification strategy and seeing through other programmes. So we've got a very, I don't want to use the term ambitious again because then you'll read too much into it, but a bold and imaginative plan around rail investment. But in terms of looking again at reopening previously closed lines, it would be nice to do, but we would need the available resources. I think all parties could agree on that, even Alec Johnston, the Conservatives, but he rushed to privatise it no sooner than we reopen it right enough, and I'm sure at that point we might disagree. But there is now cross-party support for rail in Scotland that I'm not sure existed some years ago.
I don't necessarily need an answer on that, but obviously just to flag up the importance of freight-only lines as well. As you know from the Rotterdam example, they used the 10T funding, which obviously needs to be part of the Trans-European network. As you know, I've been an advocate for many years on the fact that I don't believe that we're using the full amount of European funding is available, and frankly that's been something that successive governments need to perhaps look at. But it's perhaps something to just flag up, because clearly getting freight off our roads onto rail is crucially important, and having point-to-point freight-only lines are crucially important in the development of this.
I looked very closely at the committee's freight investigation, the inquiry, and that's why we're doing more work on freight generally, and as well as waterborne freight, of course, rail freight. And I was able to say at the parliamentary response that I gave on behalf of the government that there was one really good application underway, and it's subject to planning and other considerations as well. But I think it'll be if this one project comes off, I think it'll be particularly good to showcase what can be done through rail freight. and we will see through the recommendations that we can, that were recommended by this committee.
Thank you. Committee, I'm conscious of time. Let's concentrate on the Borders Rail specifically. Whilst it's an excellent project, you'll know from customers there's been some feedback about overcrowding concerns, particularly at peak times when there's only been two carriages on. I mean, are you emphasising to the operator the importance of meeting its contractual obligations here to make sure it allows a sufficient capacity so that we don't have unhappy and dissatisfied customers on this excellent project?
Yes, I am, and I've had very close involvement to it. And some of the figures that are now in the public domain, such as approximately 56,000 journeys to and from the seven new stations in the first 2 weeks, is very impressive, and that figure's become 126,000 over the period. So it said there's unprecedented interest in the railway. Well, of course it's unprecedented because it wasn't there before, so of course it's unprecedented. But it does even go above the more positive estimates. But the simple answer to the question is yes, I have impressed upon the operator the need for extra carriages, and extra carriages have been deployed to address the demands around that. And in some instances that has meant doubling the amount of carriages that are servicing the stations. There's other work that can be done around peak times, such as publishing timetables that can indicate which times, which departures have been busier than others, so that the occasional traveller can know when are the busiest points as well. But looking to the future, there'll be even more rolling stock in Scotland as we have the deployment of the Hitachi trains coming to Scotland and the other enhancements that are outlined in the franchise. But in terms of the immediate day-to-day operation of Borders Rail, which has been widely welcomed, there is an expectation that I've impressed upon the operator to address demand, and they've been able to do that in large measure.
Thanks. And give me my final question on this issue. If I look at the wider issue, how much pressure are you putting on Abellio to ensure that we tackle issues overcrowding and capacity problems in key lines? For example, I mean, Edinburgh to Glasgow, as we all know, most of us use that on a regular basis. There's a great source of dissatisfaction from passengers at peak times on overcrowding. What are you doing about that, Minister? That is a very, very important issue in Scottish Rail.
I think it's a very fair question, and it doesn't have the same instant fix, because this is now about the national issue of available rolling stock. But that's exactly why in the franchise agreement we've committed to new trains. I'll say to committee for the first time, not only will we have new trains, we'll have more trains in Scotland in the years to come because of the franchise agreement that we have. So that'll bring the 70 new Hitachi trains. There'll be other trains in deployment as well. And with the new trains, particularly for the Edinburgh to Glasgow route, mentioned by Mr. Stewart, they'll also have more seats. So more trains and more seats will improve the capacity of the rail network, and particularly at peak times. And that's the pinch point that the member is quite right to raise. So I can say that particularly in relation to on those central belt routes, eventually we'll have up to 50% more seats at peak times from December 2018. So you can't magic up the trains now, but I'm sure members will appreciate with the investment plans, with the franchise agreement, that will address that issue in quite a substantial way, which we're trying to future-proof for further increase in demand and patronage for the railways as well. And that's all the more reason we have to see the Edinburgh to Glasgow improvement project through, because that's about deploying these new trains and the electrification and the enhanced stations as well, because of course some of the platform work need to ensure that we can take these trains. So bringing all of that together takes time, and I'm sure we'll continue to support the railway sector.
Right. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I'm sure that you won't mind me saying, as an islander, that I very much welcome the indications you gave of the continuing investment in new ferries. And although they come under a lot of criticism, sometimes with possibly some merit, if I say that Calmac have got an affectionate place in the heart of Highlanders and Islanders, the red, white and black ships ploughing through our stormy seas often bring a wee smile to our faces when we see them, and even the names have resonance. The new hybrid ferries, the Hallig and the Loch Invar, the names have got resonance. For instance, my father as a young man worked on the previous Loch Invar, and the Hallig was named after Sorley MacLean's great poem. So we very much welcome that investment, and also your overseeing of the successful rollout of RET. You know, in combination with the forthcoming Islands Act, you mentioned the debate in Parliament yesterday. I would kind of almost paraphrase a previous Prime Minister, Harold Macmillan, in saying that islanders have just never had it so good. So, but that brings me on to my question. That brings me on to my question, and it's just to ask if you could provide an update on the procurement of the next Clyde and Hebrides ferry service contract.
Convener, I knew with that compliment there had to be a but. There had to be a difficult point. I was accused yesterday of being in the chamber on the islands debate, of being animated when talking about ferries, but that's Mike McKenzie's version of being animated in that islander kind of style. I think this is a very important issue. In terms of the procurement, it has to be conducted in accordance with the law and the regulations. But I want more than that. I want it to be conducted with confidence, and that's why I've established the independent procurement reference panel so that other people can engage with the wider process. I should say as well to Mr. McKenzie that irrespective of the outcome of whichever of the two bidders is successful, the vessels remain in public ownership. The timetables are set by Scottish Government. The fares are set by Scottish Government. And even the very branding that you described going through our waters is owned through our agencies by Scottish Government. So all of that remains the same. But we're going through the tendering process, due to be complete by the end of May next year. This is a very complex tendering exercise. There are two bidders which have been named as CalMac Ferries Limited and, of course, Circle Caledonian Ferries Limited. These bids will be analysed as we go through the different iterations of initial invitation to tender, interim invitation to tender, and that's due later in the autumn, and the final invitation to tender, which is due to issue on December 2015. There will be involvement of the panel that I've described, which is a range of representation. And if I can, because I know that other members have asked this, if it is possible to make the announcement before the end of May, I would do so. But we have to go through this very complex procurement exercise in a coherent and fully compliant way, and then report back in due course. Members will also be aware that the waiting has focused on quality and cost, and our discussions with the trade unions to give them a degree of certainty and satisfaction over the summer months as well. So hopefully that's a useful update on the procurement exercise.
Thank you. I'm sure a lot of islanders will find that reassuring. And if I could just touch on the procurement reference panel that you mentioned, and wonder if you can explain a bit more about that panel, what its function is, what its composition is.
There are a range of stakeholders involved, be it local authorities, there's island users group, there's trade union representation as well. And it's to give that extra layer of oversight. But I can assure members that the decision on the outcome of the tender rests with ministers. That can't be shared in whole or in part with any other party. That will be a matter for ministers, but if to give oversight and an understanding of the processes that we're going through, as well as visibility of the ITT, the invitation to tender, the interim invitation to tender, and also the final invitation to tender as well. So they'll be involved all the way through the process, and have committed to publish the independent procurement reference panel's meetings and findings as well.
Thank you, Minister.
Dave.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask you a specific question, Minister, on CalMac, which I assume Mr. McKenzie's admiration for? But I want to ask about specific compensation payments that have been made to passengers since 2012. Does the Minister have a rough idea how much compensation had been paid to passengers for delays since 2012 from CalMac.
I don't have that figure to hand, no, but I'm sure that you asked parliamentary questions about the wider figure in terms of payments and issues in relating to penalties to CalMac itself, but I'm happy to report back to the committee. I don't have it to hand.
I asked the question, as you probably know, last month, and the answer is £305,758. Now, that does appear to me to be a very large sum, and as you know, that's made under the EU Passenger Rights Regulations. Under the new tender, will that figure reduce or will it go higher?
It's too unpredictable. I don't think you can predict the figure because it'll be down to a range of factors such as disrupted ferries and so on. So I don't think you can reasonably predict such a figure.
I mean, were you surprised when you sent me the answer to that question?
Not necessarily, because the nature of ferry services is that they can be disrupted. I know there's technical issues around whether it's weather disruption or whether there's another reason for fault, or if you take the industrial action over this summer, different factors can play into why a service hasn't been delivered. It is highly unpredictable. Now, of course, any minister, any member would want to keep it to a minimum. You want services to operate 100% of the time, totally reliable, and never have to pay out compensation. Of course, there's a matter of the mechanism between CalMac having to recompense government through the arrangements as well if there's non-delivery of a service. So it's a very complex matter. Of course, the aspiration is to keep it to an absolute minimum, having every sailing work perfectly, but there are many factors that, in fairness, don't allow that to happen.
What happens in terms of the budget? I mean, is that 305,000, does that come out of CalMac's budget, or do you compensate as government CalMac for that figures that they're paying out?
Well, the financial arrangements with CalMac and any operator are quite complex in a franchisor and a service agreement. And if there's non-compliance, government has the ability to negotiate, to hear the case on why something's happened, or simply to take payment from the operator or a share of that payment. Equally, if we vary the contract or vary provision of services, such as I have done and propose to do with the enhanced timetable for the Chiffs contract, Clyde and Hebrides Ferry Services contract, it costs government through Transport Scotland and we would pay CalMac back. So it is quite complex, as I have discovered on inheriting the transport brief, but it is focused on delivering a service and supporting our customers and trying to minimise any disruption. But you've also got to be reasonable about that as well. I wouldn't propose to change the penalty mechanism going forward. I don't think that Mr Stewart's suggesting that either.
So in the new contract, is there anything specific about compensation payments?
There would be the ongoing continuity of the current arrangement.
Yeah. And so perhaps you can get back to us, because you won't, in the final question, because I'm conscious of time, Kavira. Perhaps you could get back to the committee and confirm, of the 305,000, how much of that has been recompensated by Scottish Government, or how much of that has had to be delivered from CalMac's own budget?
I'm happy to share more detail on that and come back to the member and the committee, but I would put that figure in the wider context, of course, of the overall transport budget and the investment to ferry services, which since 2007 is now over £1 billion, so let's put that figure into context.
Thank you. In your opening statement, you mentioned the smart ticketing system, which is obviously a feature of the new ScotRail franchise and hopefully will be part of the Clyde and Hebrides ferry service contract as well. So what more information do you have about that development and the rollout of it Scotland-wide?
Again, it's very complex. I think all governments, all ministers, all members have had the aspiration to have a smart ticketing and one device or one card that could work across a range of transport modes. And I hold that aspiration as well. And the government's got a commitment around the fulfilment of that pledge. I have been particularly active on this. And my aspiration is the following, that any smart and integrated ticketing scheme is cross-modal, cross-operator, cross-boundary, and on a national scale. So if you thought anything I said earlier was ambitious, this is particularly ambitious. And the reason for that is private operators, for example, in the bus community, will want to guard their commercial sensitivity and might not want some of those aspirations. but with ScotRail, Abellio ScotRail has expertise from their other operations on smart and integrated ticketing. Some of the bus operators do Lothian buses, for example, on their smart device. You can have the timetable, the cost of the service, and I think even payment now on that. So I think we're moving towards an opportunity of the kind of technology that exists in today's world, that we can achieve this. If I can sort out the mechanics and bring everyone to the table, then we hopefully we're able to say more about this in the National Transport Strategy. Now, I've met with the Confederation of Passenger Transport, that's the bus community, because I think they've got the furthest, that's a terrible pun, they've got most to do on this front, because we can compel it through the franchise for rail, which we've done, through the ferry franchise, which we'll do. So it is making that connection with buses. And I've said to the bus community, because it's a mixture of private and public, that I prefer for it to be done voluntarily. But if need be, I could use legislation or could use conditions of grant through our other funding schemes to the bus community or other mechanisms to compel everyone to participate in this. But it is a high ambition to have it across all modes of transport, cut across boundaries, cut across private and public sector, and be a national scale. And most people are using devices now, and so it doesn't need to be an old-fashioned card as many see it. So we're looking to the future and trying to future-proof it. But it is a huge task, but it's one that I'm very focused on trying to deliver and overcome the barriers by using all the different levers that government has at our disposal. So in terms of actual progress, there has been some around the government's entitlement card for national concessionary travel. Abellio ScotRail are working on their solution. The Glasgow Subway, of course, has their new smart card. Some bus operators have smart technology, as I've described. My task is to try and pull all of that together in a coherent way so it's as simple as possible for the travelling public and a passenger who just wants one, rather than all these different schemes trying to bring it all together. So I've commissioned work with officials, and I have an imminent meeting with Abellio ScotRail and the bus industry as well, because I think that's one of the best connections that can be made, and I'll happily report future progress on that.
I mean, I accept it's going to be a complicated challenge, and I do wish you well on it, because I think, you know, many people want this to happen, and members of this Parliament. I accept it's complicated. I accept that, you know, you're doing a lot of work on this matter, but when would you like to see this at least starting, not to be completed, not to, you know, be across Scotland, but maybe having a pilot somewhere? When would you like that?
I could give you a pilot tomorrow, but I don't think that's good enough, okay, because there's loads of examples of really good practice, but that's my problem, that they're too siloed, they're too isolated. It might work for some passengers in one part of the country, and I say Lothian buses is a good example for the bus network, but nothing happens if you get off the bus and onto a train, so it's about joining up journeys, and that's where the work has to be undertaken. And for that reason, I can't give a timescale yet. There are commitments around the fulfilment service, but I've gone beyond the previous commitment and the principles that I've outlined. And if I can get the active participation of the bus community, and I think I now have it, then I think I can make more progress. The reason I've not been shifty about this and not setting a timescale is I would be making up a date if I was to give you a timescale. But after the period of maybe 6 months, I could report back to the committee on the progress that I've made, because right now live and active discussions are underway. And that will align the plans that Abellio ScotRail have, and they have ambitious plans around their technology and the bus community as well, and what I can expect from them and bringing it all together through Transport Scotland. But I'm very clear that individual schemes are not good enough anymore. We have to bring this together and integrate it, just as we want to integrate transport itself.
Thank you. And thank you, Minister, for the offer of coming back to the committee in 6 months' time on that issue. We'll have to make sure that we align it with the period before we go into the solution. So, Adam, you have some questions.
Yeah, I'd like to raise some questions about Prestwick Airport, Minister. Ryanair recently announced its summer 2016 schedule, which includes new routes from both Edinburgh and Glasgow airports, but no new routes from Prestwick Airport. Given what might be regarded as a limited commitment from Ryanair, the only airline that operates from Prestwick Airport. Are you confident that the airport can return to profitability in a reasonable timescale?
Well, I think there's a number of issues there, and Mr. Brown leads on Prestwick Airport because of my constituency interest at Glasgow Airport. But I can say that there's a new five-year plan that's been worked on at the moment, and Ryanair has maintained their commitment to Glasgow Prestwick Airport and said they'll continue there. Of course, not just passenger flights, but I understand their maintenance, repair and overhaul facility is also there, and that's welcomed. And it helps make the point about Prestwick Airport that it's not just about passenger numbers. There's air freight issues there as well. There's the potential of the spaceport too that they're taking forward a very positive bid on. So in terms of the commercial deal that we have with Prestwick, not to disadvantage any other Scottish airport, we are focusing on trying to support the airport in terms of growth, but it is wider than just passenger growth, and Ryanair has maintained their commitment there. And the current review of the business plan, I think, should inspire confidence as to its future.
In terms of business development, then, the senior management team recently stepped down at Prestwick Airport and permanent replacements are still to be appointed. Can you provide an update on the appointment of permanent senior managers and how you expect their appointment to actually develop the business at Prestwick and take it forward to profitability?
Members will be aware that Mr. Richard Jenner has been appointed the interim chief executive officer, and there will be other recruitment process underway. I think the point is well made by Mr. Ingram around the issue of ensuring that the board has the skills, the capacity and the expertise to work with the business community to expand the offer at Prestwick Airport. So yes, there would be an expectation in the appointment there of people who can deliver that aspiration. And when we embark upon recruitment exercise, you look at that variety and that skill base and that expertise and the business acumen as well. And we are increasingly confident that that will be there for the period going forward.
Well, the previous senior managers, I think, completed their tenure at the end of September. So do you envisage the interim manager in the form of Richard Jenner? How long do you anticipate him being in that position prior to the appointment of a permanent management team?
Mr. Brown has closer day-to-day involvement with these matters, and it's more of a question for him with that closer involvement, as I say, because of my constituency interest, and I wouldn't want to prejudice the recruitment process either. If members want further information on those timescales, I'm happy to have Mr. Brown write to you on that. But as I say, everything that I've seen, I'm certainly more confident of the direction of travel for the board and the management of Prestwick Airport, and as they review the business plan, I understand from those involved that there's plenty of reasons to be positive. And of course there's other bids and live discussions underway as to the commercial nature of the airport.
Thank you.
Dave.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, can I ask you a few questions around buses, but the wider issue I'd like to link in is in with air pollution. You'll be well aware from the work, the good work that Friends of the Earth have done, that there's concerns that around 3,500 people are dying prematurely because of air pollution. And clearly we're all concerned, I think, about the scandal around Volkswagen cheating software. And we know that the bulk of the pollution comes from road traffic. I was looking at some work that the Herald had done that showed that if you look at Hope Street in Glasgow, nitrogen dioxide was 62% above the European legal limit. And DEFRA in Westminster have looked at arguing that pre-2015 diesels, cars and lorries and indeed buses should be banned from key cities, including London and Leeds. Clearly we've got very similar problems in Scotland. What's your view about when you're looking at reviewing and consulting the powers of local authorities on the operation of bus markets to put some conditionality that buses in particular in urban areas, I'm not talking about long distance routes, should be non-diesel? And if I flag up some good examples, when I visited Stagecoach in Inverness, when they have a fleet of green buses running on electric, which I would applaud the work they have done. What's your view on this general issue? And obviously we have to look at integrated planning. It's no point having one policy in transport when we're finding that the NHS is under strain because of the great problem of air pollution, because frankly we're not doing enough about diesel pollution, particularly in our cities.
I think it's a very valid point. There's a range of works around decarbonising the transport network, and in terms of government departments working with each other, National Planning Framework 3 that I know the member was involved with and scrutinising does look across portfolios to focus on the decarbonisation agenda. On road, for example, we're looking to completely decarbonise the road network by 2050, and that means moving to issues such as electric vehicles. So on that front, for example, there's a number of charging points now across the country for electric vehicles, and we're trying to stimulate support for electric vehicles. On and staying with vehicles just for a moment, cars, the VW issue is of great concern to the Scottish Government, and we've written to UK Government to request that a task force be convened so that we can take a cross-government approach to that very issue, because they'll have other powers that we don't have around enforcement. And there's now a whole panoply of issues that have been exposed as a consequence of that emissions expose. So that is of great concern. On road traffic, actually, local authorities can take a degree of action now around quality bus partnerships and potentially quality contracts for buses. But for quality bus partnerships and other restrictions, local authorities are already empowered to make decisions at the most local level that are right for them. And that can be around the quality of air, emissions and quality of vehicles as well. But to further support that, the government consulted on our air quality strategy, I think, which will make further decisions around low emission zones, which can do some of the things that Mr. Stewart has suggested. And on aviation, you just touched upon, then there is further work that can be done around technology and ensuring that flights are going are fuller rather than empty. As a practical example, and UK government has more of a role around the Civil Aviation Authority, but clearly airplanes can become cleaner as well. And on public transport, trying to encourage more people onto public transport, that's a commitment the government makes, by over £1 billion every year, I referred to in my opening statement. And on the transition from older diesel buses into new technology, government through the Scottish Green Bus Fund and the Bus Investment Fund, and how we incentivise potentially through the Bus Services Operators Grant, is encouraging the bus community to move to cleaner, greener, newer buses as well. And the Aberdeen example is a good one as well, of hydrogen buses. And I witnessed just in Parliament a week or two ago new electric buses that may be deployed in Scotland as well. So with our limited funding, we're trying to encourage public and private providers to move to cleaner, greener forms of energy. And in terms of the regulatory power, local authorities can act now and could potentially do even more following on from the air quality strategy.
Convener, of course, I agree with the Minister when he says we need to get people using public transport. But if I could play devil's advocate, if you're waiting for a bus in Hope Street in Glasgow, there's no point going on a bus if it's a diesel pollutant, which is then causing air pollution issues. I mean, the Minister won't have in his head the number of buses in urban Scotland that are diesel. But clearly, we need to do action similar to the smoking ban here. The Minister probably didn't listen to Radio 4 yesterday in the afternoon, which had an interesting debate about the use of diesel in our cities. And one of the commentators, and I'm not necessarily saying this is my position, was basically making a comparison with the smoking ban and saying that he saw no case for lorries or buses being diesel-powered in our cities in the future. I mean, because of the effect it's having on our health service. Now, that is a radical move, but clearly we need to do more. So when it comes to conditionality, in other words, funding for buses, can the Minister do more to try and ensure that buses are not diesel-powered in our cities? I'm not talking about long-distance routes in our cities in the future.
Well, there's a different way to approach that, but just before I come to it, that'll explain, if Mr Stewart was listening to Radio 4 yesterday afternoon, that explains why you weren't at the islands debate in the chamber of the Scottish Parliament where I expected to see you, but that's, of course, choices that...
I didn't realise the Minister had changed to become the Labour Chief Whip, but if he wants that, if he wants that job, I'm sure it would be open to him.
There are some jobs I may aspire to in government. I've never thought of that one, but I think we'll leave it... there. On the issue, the serious issue of emissions, the other way into this is not necessarily just to ban diesel from certain areas through funding. We are actually trying to incentivise the funding package to allow for and support cleaner, greener buses. And there's European regulations, of course, that stipulate what buses will be allowed on our roads. In addition to that, we've been encouraging operators to move to hydrogen vehicles or electric vehicles, other forms of greener transport. But as well as that, there are powers to restrict the type of vehicles because of their emissions and the pollutants from certain parts. And it's a good example to raise around the cities or those areas that clearly have had a health impact or air quality is a particular issue. So there are powers that are there, and they will be strengthened as a consequence of that government consultation I referenced earlier. There is also a very careful balancing act. I entirely accept the health issue around pollutants and the impact they cause. But I also know if we were disproportionate in our approach or didn't work in partnership with the bus community and they simply pulled a number of routes, I think that that would also leave people exposed in a different way. So we absolutely have to get more progress in this, but not in a way that undermines people's quality of life or accessibility or connectivity as an indirect and unintended consequence of that view.
And my final point, could the Minister have a look at an article that Sunday Times did on, obviously on Sunday, about the use of emission cameras? I don't know if the Minister has come across that, but it's basically an ADAR system, which is an emission detection and reporting device. So it's a bit like a speed camera, but instead of measuring speed, it measures emissions. And this has been introduced European-wide, and DEFRA certainly having a look at that. So, for example, if I could use my Hope Street example again, that you could actually have cameras that can measure emissions from individual buses, lorries, and indeed cars, which is... There is, of course, current systems that measure pollutants. I'm merely saying this new system is distinctly designed to measure diesel pollution, and I'd certainly highlight the Minister looking at this use of this product across Scotland.
Okay.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Adam.
I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Minister, but you mentioned in the opening remarks you're intending to launch a consultation with a view to perhaps new legislation with regards to local bus markets. As you're aware from my correspondence with you, there are a number of issues with the private operators and operating socially necessary routes, and we've had to have interventions from the passenger transport authorities to subsidise routes. Is this an area that you're looking at in terms of going forward?
Well, I have made it clear to... What predated some of that was my willingness to work with Ian Gray on his bus bill. Now, I think it was largely misunderstood. It's not fair that Ian Gray is misunderstood, largely misunderstood. But I said I would work with Ian Gray, as Mr Stewart knows, because he brokered and facilitated the meeting, to work with him on some of the issues he raised. He's decided not to continue with his bill, but I have put the bus community very much... on alert that if I feel that they aren't delivering in a way that we would expect, then we may take action in the future. What I propose for the meantime, though, is an immediate change to how operators engage with local authorities. So I'll imminently, or later this month, depends your definition of imminently, but lay in Parliament a change to regulation so that there's better and more time for engagement between operators and local authorities when they're changing bus routes through the registration process, and I'll revise the guidance on how this should be done. So that's the first action. We're also looking at how we can improve on quality contracts, you know, where you can bundle routes and have greater degree of control over routes, and supporting quality bus partnerships, which, you know, there should be more of in Scotland. There are no quality contracts in Scotland and some quality bus partnerships. So it's about strengthening what's there at the moment, tightening up on operators, engaging with local authorities. But I've made it clear to the CPT, the Confederation of Passenger Transport, the bus operators essentially, that I expect them to do their bit. Mr Ingram's also right. Where there's a gap in service, where there's a social need, local authorities or regional transport partnerships can intervene. That's not a nice to do. That is actually their function. And I think some do need reminded of that, which is why it will feature in the National Transport Strategy, so that people aren't left isolated in what is a mixed market in terms of bus provision.
Okay. Mike.
Thank you, Convener. You recently announced, Minister, a review of the office and the role of the Scottish Roads Works Commissioner. Can you explain why you thought such a review was necessary and how you hope to see the role of the Roads Works Commissioner develop?
I felt that with the opportunity, the opportunity came to appoint a new Roads Works Commissioner, that there was also an opportunity to see how the post and the role could be improved. Because of the role that there is, it's arbiter, it's a regulator, enforcer, I think there's much that can be done, and as keeper of the roadworks register as well. So I'm taking the opportunity to look again at the role and see if we can do better coordinate, maybe even strengthen the powers to have a stronger role around this, and what's the relationship with Transport Scotland as well as part of that review. So I'll have a new commissioner, they'll do the work, and at the same time conduct a review to see how we can do better, because I am of the view that we could probably do more with this role.
Thank you. And my final question, Minister, is just that, and I'm sure all of us that use the roads observe that road traffic's at a new peak, but also that more trips have been delayed due to congestion than previously has been the case. Could you maybe indicate what Transport Scotland is doing to reduce travel demand and also to combat congestion?
Certainly. So there's a massive investment programme, and that will address some of the capacity matters and the pinch points and improving road infrastructure particularly. And within some of that, it'll be about prioritising public transport as well, also making public transport more attractive, whether that's road or bus, encouraging active travel as well. And there's a range of other government initiatives such as car sharing. So if you have fewer cars, then that would be more helpful as well. So car sharing and travel plans through the local authorities. But the roadworks themselves will cause some disruption. And I said in my earlier comments that it is regrettable that there will be congestion as a consequence of major investment. But we're even able to, whilst not compromising on safety, adapt some of the works as well where there's been pinch points or extra demand on the system to even adapt the work programme or adapt routes. And Traffic Scotland also provides information and congestion on the road network too. And last time I was at committee, I was celebrating it had over 80,000 Twitter followers. Well, I can report now over 90,000 Twitter followers. I'm only at 9,000, which I think is a controversy in itself, a ministerial, a personal account. But the fact that there's so much information out there is trying to give real-time information about where the congestion is. The long-term investment plans help with capacity, investment in the roads. And I'm well aware of members' concern about the legacy of repairs to the roads infrastructure as well. But we spend over a quarter of £1 billion every year on the maintenance of the trunk road and motorways, but I'm aware there's legacy issues as well of the condition of the existing roads, as well as the commitments we've made on new roads. But you have to look at the M73, M74, M8, the AWPR work, as well as, of course, the complete M74 missing link as major steps forward in addressing that strategic congestion, but encouraging people to use public transport as another way forward as well. The final point I'd make around congestion is if people could just pay close attention to the transport advice that's given, because sometimes it's road incidents and collisions and driver behaviour that sometimes causes some congestion as well, and to be very mindful of that advice that's offered through Transport Scotland. And winter, of course, brings its own challenges around transport disruption, and I can assure all members that the full range of winter preparations are very much underway, and I'll make a statement to Parliament fairly soon, I understand, on those winter preparations.
Thank you, Minister. That was a very comprehensive answer.
Thank you. Do members have any further questions? Minister, do you have any final remarks you'd like to place on the record?
No.
In that case, can I thank you for your evidence this morning, and can I thank you also for your commitment to provide a series of updates to the committee on a range of issues. Can I just remind you what those are? The establishment of a stakeholder group to support the National Transport Strategy, progress on major trunk road projects, an update on the Active Travel Summit and the National Walking Strategy, the Smart Ticketing Scheme, compensation to CalMac passengers, and the impact on tax receipts of reducing and then possibly finally abolishing air passenger duty as that power comes to the Parliament, and also your offer to liaise with your colleague, the Cabinet Secretary, and ensuring that we have an update on the appointment of a new senior management team at Glasgow Prestwick Airport. Once again, can I thank you and your officials for your attendance this morning. We now move into private session. I now close this meeting of the committee.